the sense, if you will, of what the Word of God is calling for in the lives of New Testament believers who refer to themselves as New Testament Christians. Are you listening to me? Good to see Brother Zach tonight and others that are here. Now, tonight we're going to, as I mentioned before, digress from our normal subject matter that we will be continuing in the near future. There are a number of reasons for this, but one is that this is an evangelical week, or a week of, someone say a week of evangelism. What that means is, as we preached on Sunday, we need you to understand that it is not rocket science for us to reach out to other people who need salvation and invite them for this week's revival with evangelist Naomi Cecily. I believe there is not one person in this building tonight, and many who are absent, who cannot attest to the fact that the ministry of evangelist Cecily has had some sort of positive spiritual impact upon your life. Certainly it has had a positive spiritual impact upon my life. And so I certainly have to give credence and praise to God and thanksgiving for how she has allowed the Lord to use her to bless multitudes of those of us who are in the body of Christ and or individuals who were not in the body of Christ, but through influence of her ministry came in contact with the gospel of Jesus Christ and came into the body of Christ. So she will be here Wednesday night. Now Wednesday, specifically her focus will be at Michigan State University. She will be going there to train those of you that are a part of Young Apostolic Students for Christ and those who are in the general ministry there in Lansing that would like to come and be a part of the training. Certainly she will be there for that purpose. And if you know people in Lansing that want to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, then she will be there to minister to these individuals and assist them in the same. Evangelist Luann Stewart. Stewart is supposed to be attending to her for the 2 days she is here. She will be coming in on tomorrow evening. Can the church say amen? And so we encourage you, if you will, to be available if you are part of the campus ministry. Certainly the campus ministry from Eastern Michigan University can feel free, if someone can call them tonight, Brother Fitz, let them know they can feel free to join the campus ministry at Michigan State. There's no prohibition of this taking place. Well, after all, the end run is for the salvation of what? For souls to be saved. And so this is why we are now making these announcements. On Thursday night, those of you that want healing and want blessing and want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you want blessings for your personal life, you want blessings for the life of members in your family who are sick, I would suggest that you be here. Now, she prayed for me. I was having serious complications a few months ago, and I talked with her about some recommendations that the cardiologist was making, and I called her personally and asked her to go into prayer. And so she prayed on the phone, and then they went into prayer all over the country. And quite frankly, God did something for me, because when I went in for the previous tests, the news wasn't good. After they prayed, I went in for the follow-up test, and the news was very good. Can we say amen? So you're very foolish if you do not get here on Thursday. It will be to your own detriment. It will be to your own hurt. When you and I all know we have things in our life, or we have things in the lives of other people who are our loved ones or our affiliates, our associates, our relatives that are sick, ill, and need the help of God, the thing to do is to get here. When God presents an opportunity for you to engage him on the level of healing, because a person who has given their lives completely to this venue of ministry is coming, then it makes sense for you to bring yourself and or others with you so that they may be blessed through her ministry. So she will be teaching on Thursday night, ministering to the choir. All choir members are asked to be here, praise team members, musicians, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, she will be ministering also on Friday night. Teaching on Thursday, and the choir will be singing and she'll be ministering on Friday. This is an opportunity for those of you that are here to bring people to be saved. So this is your opportunity not to make excuses now, as we preached on Sunday. If this country can pull together and defeat three of the most powerful nations on the face of the earth, imperialist Japan, fascist Italy, and Nazi Germany. These were the three nations we defeated during World War II. And of course, we came up with all kinds of inventions and all kinds of innovations to engage them to beat back the spread of these dictatorships and these terrible things that were ceasing to overthrow the ability of people to pursue their participation in faith and in their religion. Are you listening to me? And rob individuals of their freedoms. So we're asking you, not asking you to build any B-29 bombers or B-52 bombers or Apache helicopters or come up with any some sort of military and scientific invention that is going to transform the world. We simply ask you to bring someone to be introduced to the gospel of who? Thank you. And thank you for that. I wish you would teach the others how to do that. God bless you. Can the church say hallelujah? And so this then is, and Ian's not here yet. Well, wait till he shows. You can bring it around, but wait till he shows. And so this then is why we're admonishing and encouraging you to please, if you will, it is the right thing to do, participate and involve yourself in the effort to reach people with the gospel of what? Of Jesus Christ. Can the church say amen? And so on tonight, we're going to digress a bit from what we usually teach or what we have been teaching. Sometimes it's good to get away from that subject anyway. We've been in the book of Corinthians for several weeks. We're into the 8th and 9th chapter. We probably will be finishing up over the next few weeks, but we want you to have a comprehensive understanding of the 1st and 2nd epistles of Corinthians, because many times we don't read our Bibles, Brother Zach. And so then if the pastor will take the Bible and rightly divide it for us and have us read it verse by verse, touch one and say, at least we can say we read that book. So if you didn't read all 66 books, at least you, if you were here consistently, at least you would have gotten through one of the 66 books in the Bible. And of course, we are required to do better than that. Touch your neighbor and say, we have to do better than that. Now tonight, many have the baptism of the Holy Spirit in the realm of Christianity. In the nominal churches, in Christendom, that is the whole kingdom of religious spirituality where people refer to themselves as Christians, there are many that have the baptism of the Holy Spirit as we know it, speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives utterance. It is referred to in the Britannica Encyclopedia as the glossolalia experience. And this glossolalia experience, G-L-O-C-I-A, I believe it is L-I-A, if I think it's spelled that way. This is an experience that is identified with the outpouring of the baptism of the Holy Spirit during the Azusa Revival in the Azusa Street Mission in Los Angeles, California, from about 1900 through about 1910. Just giving you a round figures period of time in which this is really supposed to have taken place. Really, it's about 1906 to 1910 or 1904 to 1910. But nevertheless, this is where this is identified with historically in this country as a religious phenomenon. Now, you must understand that the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World as an organization began in the Azusa Revival. It held its first business meeting in 1906. We have minutes from that business meeting in 1907 in our History of the PAW Minute Book. And the PAW at that time was a Trinitarian organization. This then meant that we had not come to the knowledge of the oneness of the Godhead in Christ Jesus. That means God manifested in three manifestations, because we will show you tonight there's not three persons in the Godhead, but there are, someone say, three manifestations of one God. This is a scriptural term. And when we refer to God, we must refer to him as the scriptures refer to him, not as theologians refer to him, and not as Bible scholars and religious scholars refer to him. It is appropriate for us to refer to him according to the scriptures. And so we came as